Hey guys, welcome back to Reserved Investments on YouTube and welcome to my 6,000 subscriber Q&A. Hopefully this will be the finale. We will see. First question. Sean, can you highlight some examples of times that you bought into collectibles at their all-time highs? Yes, just go back and watch some of the other segments in my Q&A videos. I do talk an awful lot about this. Marbles, Pez dispensers, vintage toy robots. I said this before. I remember in 1995, I came across a collection of very, very complete mint and box vintage toy robots and space toys from the 1950s and 60s that a collector had, and I ended up buying the whole collection for $5,000. Well, all I had to do was consign that collection to an auction house or flip them through eBay or the like, and I would have doubled my money in most cases, probably almost tripled it. Instead, what does Sean decide to do? Sean says, you know what? I'm involved in too many markets right now, and I rent a storage unit, and I throw these particular items in the storage unit. Then 10, 15 years later, I remember, hey, I have this collection of vintage toy robots and space toys from the 1950s and 60s to sell. So I go and I consign them to auction. And guess what? Guess how much I got for the collection? $5,000. So a lot of these markets, you have to understand opportunity cost. And that was a very good lesson to me because obviously back in the 1990s, if I would have just took that same $5,000 and put it in S&P 500 index fund and done nothing with it, not had to worry about a thing, I could tell you I probably would have $25,000, $30,000, $35,000 today. So that is something that needs to be learned. You got to understand the cost of money, time value of money, and opportunity cost in all these markets. That's why I disagree. A lot of you guys come into the comment section. You say, Sean, if I pay $5,000 for this item and I sell it in 10 years and I break even, I did okay. And I have to look at you and I say, no, you did horrible. I don't think you understand. That $5,000 invested in a total stock market index fund, S&P 500 index fund, or pretty much any other mutual fund, for the most part, if you just leave it in there, you don't touch it, you don't play with the dividends, you just let it compound, I can assure you, as long as the overall stock market doesn't take a crap, you're okay. And even if the overall stock market does take a crap while you have your money in there, I would tell you to put more money in there because then when the market corrects, you're going to have even more that much money in gains. So you really have to take a very, very critical look at how these markets work over the long term and even over the short term in some instances. Now you go on to ask, Sean, what exactly happened when the bubble deflated? Well, obviously, if you go back to the 1990s and you study, or I should say the early 2000s, and study what happened with Beanie Babies, a lot of people were very upset. That market has yet to come back. I don't see that market ever coming back, except in certain circumstances. I really think that market manipulators are going to try to make Beanie Babies a thing again simply because there's so many out there. It would be very easy to go into that market, take like a couple $1,000, buy up all these vintage Beanie Babies, and then claim this is the next big thing. As a matter of fact, you can kind of see that happening. There are certain less credible YouTubers out there that are trying to prime the pump in this market. There's articles online. If you Google like Beanie Babies value, you're going to come across these ridiculous articles that claim that Beanie Babies are going up in value again. That is nonsense, guys. I am telling you, be very careful if you fall for any of that. What I will tell you is though, normally when a bubble deflates in the overall antiques and collectibles trade, it just depends on what the item is in question. For instance, Pez dispensers. Pez dispensers are pretty much selling at all-time lows right now, with few exceptions. Again, with few exceptions, please quote me properly if you're going to quote me on this. But I will say that market is most likely not going to come back. Even though a lot of people argue with me, well, Sean, when little Timmy S. Poindexter goes to the supermarket with his mom at the age of 5 or 6, she's going to end up buying him a Pez dispenser. That does not mean little Timmy S. Poindexter is going to want to collect vintage Pez dispensers from the 1970s, 80s, 90s, and the like, and he's going to become this massive collector and put all this money in Pez dispensers, start an online collecting forum, and get other people to invest in Pez dispensers. That does not normally happen in the antiques and collectibles trade. People collect what they know. People collect what they have an emotional attachment to. And more importantly, a collector must be born. They are not made. You cannot convince somebody to come and become a collector. That's why if you go to Wall Street and you talk about investing in antiques and collectibles, there's people that are gonna look at you like you're effing crazy. Like, what the hell do I wanna do with investing in antiques and collectibles? It's not something I wanna get into. That's what a lot of people will tell you. It's because they don't have the collecting gene. They were not born to be a collector. So that is important. Next question you asked is, what did you learn from this once the dust settled? Here it is. You ready for me to slap you upside the face with a stale donut? You ready? Here it is. There's no such thing as a blue chip investment in the overall antiques and collectibles trade. And I don't care. A lot of you guys call me out in this. Well, Sean, when you did a video on Magic the Gathering or rare coins, you referred to something in that market as a blue chip collectible. Yes, when we are comparing that market as a whole, meaning if you're going to invest in Magic the Gathering, those of you that are going after $1 or $5 reserve list cards, I'm sorry, you're making a grave mistake. The person who's going to succeed in that market, he's the guy that's able to afford and go after a PSA 8, a PSA 9, a PSA 10, alpha, beta, dual land. That's how you invest in that market. So if we look at that market from a micro level, not a macro level, a micro level. If you put a gun to my head and you said that I had to invest in Magic the Gathering and I had to turn a profit, obviously I'm going to go towards the higher end top 5% of that market. I'm not going to bother with the lower value stuff. So when we look just at that market as a whole, the blue chips would be your Alpha Dual Lands, your Alpha Black Lotus, your factory sealed boxes of Legends, Antiquities, Arabian Nights, if you can find it. Even starter decks from Unlimited or Beta or Alpha, those are the blue chips. But when you step back and you say, okay, Sean, now you got to compare the entire antiques and collectibles trade to that of any other asset class out there, whether we're talking gold, real estate, stocks, bonds, mutual funds, ETFs, I'm here to tell you, there is no such thing as a blue chip investment in the antiques and collectibles trade. Let me say it again for the Timmies in the back that are shaking their head, that have already shut off the video, that are unsubscribing from this channel en masse. There is no such thing as a blue chip investment in the antiques and collectibles trade. If you do not see the difference between an S&P 500 index fund and that of any type of antique or collectible, if it's all speculation to you, you are completely lost. You do not understand the fundamentals of investing and comparing asset classes. And that's why when I state this on this channel, every time I present this topic, I either get hateful emails, I get hateful comments, or people just unsubscribe from the channel because they cannot handle that. That is a red pill truth if you are investing in any type of alternate asset class. It's just like when the crypto kings and the wonderful Bitcoin gurus come at me and say, there's no better investment than cryptocurrency. I look at them and I say, yes, there is. And I have 100 years of data that says otherwise. When we look towards the stock market, when we look towards real estate investing, when we look towards traditional asset classes, some of you guys are completely nuts. You are involved in speculation. You are not investing in anything. And this is what I tell you guys. If you're going to build a solid financial foundation, do it with traditional asset classes. Then when you get to a certain point, you can branch out and you can diversify in other asset classes. For instance, let me just tell you this. If I wanted to invest in crypto, now full disclosure, you guys know how I feel about crypto. At present time, I have no exposure to crypto. But let's say that I wanted to come to the dark side and I wanted to try investing in cryptocurrency. If I go to the market and I put $10,000, $20,000 in cryptocurrency, because I already have hundreds upon hundreds of thousands of dollars sitting in stocks, mutual funds, ETFs, bonds, real estate, and the like, if that $10,000, $20,000 that I put in crypto goes to zero, I'm not going to be hurting. Some of you guys, though, that are going off in that direction and you're putting everything you have in gold and crypto, in antiques and collectibles, if those markets tank or they don't start to present superior returns over the next 10, 20 years like they are right now, you guys are going to be in trouble because you are not financially established. Get yourself financially established. I don't care if you got to work two jobs. You know, some of you guys come to me and you go, Sean, you don't understand. I work a job, but I'm also putting all my money in Pokemon or Magic the Gathering or Lego, whatever it is, because I'm going to be the next YouTuber out there that has already done that, and you guys watch his videos or her videos, and you think that's the path to quick wealth. And I sit there and say, are you really watching all of that person's videos? Do you hear them talk about real estate holdings, corporate bonds, stocks, mutual funds, other assets that they hold? Are you just pulling out what you want to believe because it fits your confirmation bias? And you go, oh, well, this person did this, I'm going to do that. Why do you guys come to me, even on the consulting side? And what is it that I tell you guys? You guys bring me a spreadsheet and you go, here, Sean, here's my numbers. You're making $4, $8, sometimes $9, $10 an hour in Pokemon or Lego or Magic the Gathering. Yes, I'm not trying to discourage you. I appreciate the hustle. But my niece literally just graduated high school. She's going to head off to college like next month, September, October. And she works at Target and she makes close to $17 an hour. So therefore, my niece with no formal education outside of a diploma makes more money than you spending X number of hours playing with Pokemon cards, Magic the Gathering, Flesh and Blood, Lego, whatever it is. And I know you're going to argue with me. Well, Sean, that's an elitist thing to say. Look at where you're at. I never started at that point, guys. When I would do my numbers, when I was literally flipping antiques and collectibles on eBay, if it ever got to the point where I said, you know, I'm putting in all this work, I'm only making $7 or $8 an hour, hell, I would go get a job in a warehouse moving boxes and earn more than that. That's why I put so much pressure on myself to succeed. Even in my corporate job now, my corporate job, the reason why I work a corporate job, this is probably going to shock some of you. It's not for the money. It's for the benefits. It's for healthcare, vacation time, matching 401k, all that other stuff. I know in corporate America today, even if you are college educated like me, I'm going to tell you, if you get a four-year degree, I don't care what the four-year degree is, and you go work in a cubicle farm, you're going to earn anywhere from $40,000 to $75,000. That's pretty much the norm across the board. Now, there are variations, standard variations from that, where maybe you become like a senior manager or a director or something like that, where you're making $80,000, $85,000, maybe $100,000. On the other end, maybe you don't quite hit it where you're earning $45,000, $50,000. Maybe you come in at $38,000. So there are variations to the rule. But I'm just telling you, you guys got to look at opportunity cost. You guys got to look at how much time you're spending in some of these markets. I'm a consultant in the trade, guys. I also write for publications. As a result, I have to devote my time to studying these markets. Some of you come to me and you tell me, Sean, I've been studying this market for the last 20 hours last week. I'm like, why are you studying a collecting category for 20 hours when your numbers show that you're making literally $6 or $7 speculating on these items? Dude, you need to go for a hike. You need to go for a long walk in the woods, and you really need to search yourself and understand where you want to be. Because I'm going to tell you, I'm going to state this up front. Some of you guys, man, you get into the dating world when you're in your 30s or 40s. I'm going to tell you, I'm going to be very honest with you. Most women, even average looking women, have insane expectations. They want the guy who literally has the money, who has it all together. They don't want a project or somebody who's a mess, who never went to college, who is trying to figure all this stuff out at the age of 35 or 36. You are going to get chosen over, meaning you're going to get walked over. That chick is going to look at you and go, this dude's a fucking mess. He's got what's best for you. I do not try to insult any of my viewers, anybody. We're all at different levels. But what I want is you guys to really work on yourself financially, physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually. And sometimes it comes to the realization, you know, I really wish that I could sell collectibles online 24/7. But when I analyze my dreams, goals, and what I need out of life, what I want out of life, where I'm at in life, it's not a practical solution. Why do you think a lot of YouTubers like me spend so much time talking about what's involved if you open up a retail location, if you open up a store, even flipping collectibles online? I don't think you guys realize the amount of time it takes to get in some of these markets, how much work is involved in them. That's why when you guys reach out to me and say, Sean, you're just jealous because you're not buying any of these high-profile video games. Dude, I'm going to be 45 years of age. I'm sorry. My mindset is completely different than putting together a vintage video game collection at present time. Chances are, in the past, I probably owned multiple copies of every Nintendo game out there, and I flip them on the secondary market. And that's probably why I'm sitting pretty with real estate investing, mutual funds, ETFs, and the like. And guess what, guys? The reason why I started this channel, I want that for you as well. I don't want you to be a 70-year-old guy who sits in a room filled with all antiques and collectibles, thinking that that stuff has a lot of value when your whole life passed you by. You didn't spend any time living. There's a lot of people that reach out to me with a lot of regrets, and it's very interesting to see both ends of the spectrum, both younger people and older people. There's people that watch this channel. I'm going to tell you this right now. I have a guy that does consulting with me. He runs a hedge fund out of New York. He lives in Connecticut. Very wealthy guy. He was married to two crazy chicks. He literally married a chick with borderline and or narcissistic personality disorder. She cheated on him. He had to pretty much give up half of what he had to get her out of the marriage. Then, get this, he married another chick that was similarly insane. Now, I am pro-marriage. I am all for marriage. But some of you guys do some stupid shit to the point where I just bang my head against the wall and go, what the hell? How do you go through something like that and then go through it again? You guys didn't learn the first time. I get it. If you tell me, hey, Sean, I didn't know she was crazy. I know what to look for the next time. I'll never do that again. Hey, you learned your lesson. It's no different. Some of you guys coming into these markets, Sean, I put all my money in Pokemon cards, Magic the Gathering. You don't understand. This is going to work out. It's going to be great. At some point, you're going to get hit in the face with a stale donut. Learn from the fucking mistake. Don't make the same mistake again and again and again and expect someone like me to extend empathy and go, oh, let me help you out. Let me tell you what you're doing wrong. Because at that particular point, I got to ask, hey, third time's a charm. You learning anything yet here, Timmy? Okay, so that's the end of the lesson here. Let's go on to another question. I don't know. If I did editing, I would probably edit a lot of that out. I'm not going to, though. I'm going to see where this falls. I know people are going to hate that 10-minute lecture thrown in here, but we'll see where it goes. Next question. Sean, can you talk a little bit about the 20 Super Mario Brothers Game & Watch units that you bought? I followed that particular video that you did and your advice and bought 15 of these. Okay, I did reword this question because this particular individual keeps asking me for my opinion on those particular units that I bought. If you don't know what I'm referring to, for the 35th anniversary of Super Mario Brothers, they did release a limited edition, which really wasn't limited, but Nintendo did make a limited run edition of the Super Mario Brothers Game & Watch handheld unit, and they re-released it. Well, that particular unit sold for $49.99. I did have a chance to buy 20 of them, and I took it. I actually have some that are still sealed in their factory cases. I did state that, yes, I consider that a good short-term speculative bet. Now, we are sitting in 2021. In 2021, some of those handheld units are still available at stores around the country and even around the world. So we have to wait for that supply to dry up, and then we have to wait for collector demand to build for that particular item. Then you will see it potentially going up in value on the secondary market. Now, there's an excellent catalyst that occurred in this market that I do want to alert your attention to. If you guys recall, for the 35th anniversary of The Legend of Zelda, Nintendo is going to be releasing a Legend of Zelda Game & Watch unit, which most collectors, if they get one or the other, they're going to want to collect them all. Now, if this becomes a trend where Nintendo keeps releasing these little unique full-color handheld units that are based on a lot of their popular properties or franchises, yes, a collecting market is going to emerge for that particular collectible. Was I a little bit ambiguous in saying that you're going to be able to flip it in 3 to 5 years? Well, it's only been a year thus far, so I don't think I was too ambiguous in that. What I will tell you is this particular market is probably going to take some time to develop. Now, another thing you have to understand is these particular items, these Game & Watch units that Nintendo is now releasing, these are utilizing mass-produced scarcity. There's very little organic collectability there. What we want to see is, once these items are absorbed into the overall marketplace, is organic collectability going to take hold? And will collectors go, you know what? I know it retailed for $49.99, but you can't get it anywhere. I don't mind paying $100 for that just to add it to my collection. I am betting that over the next several years, the answer is possibly yes. So that's why I am comfortable in the decision I made in buying those particular 20 units and putting them in storage in a holding pattern. You cannot expect to just go to the market, buy this stuff, and then flip it immediately if it's still being sold on the primary retail market, which this item is. It's no different than all you guys that reached out to me. Oh my gosh, I got to get my copy of Super Mario 3D All-Stars. Well, here we are in 2021. I can go to my local Target and Walmart stores, and they still have Super Mario 3D All-Stars sitting on the store shelves. So many copies of that game were made and sold. It is mind-boggling. Do I think at some point it will have some collectability, some value? Yes, but it's going to take years. And in some cases, it could take longer than years. I'm okay sitting on items like that. I don't mind because, again, going back to my first point, I'm financially established. What I am going at here is you guys got to get yourself to the next level. You got to level up financially, physically, emotionally, mentally, spiritually. I don't care how you define it. Go become more, do something, build something, put together a plan. I don't care if you got to work two jobs. Yes, I know it sucks. Yes, I know, America, we have wealth inequality. I get it. Guess what? You carrying a sign, and trust me, I'm a liberal progressive when I say this, you carrying a sign that wealth inequality sucks and holding it in front of Congress or the Senate or the White House isn't going to resolve the problem, guys. All you're doing is hurting yourself because you're not working on yourself to find a way to successfully succeed in a capitalistic society. And that's what I teach. Even though my core beliefs, I'm with you, my brothers and sisters. I am a liberal progressive. Believe me, I've done my fair share of activism in my day. And I will tell you, it did very little. We're in a day and age where we're putting individual rights over healthcare. And it's very interesting. And I'm not taking a side on this equation. I'm not taking a position here. But I'm just stating, it's very interesting what is happening, why we're seeing this all unfold. That's why it's very interesting times we are living in. So I'm going to get into the next question. And this is more of a personal question, but I do want to take the time to answer it. Sean, what are some of your regrets in life? Okay, this is a very depressing question. Yes, I was hit with what would be diagnosed as celiac disease roughly in my late 20s and early 30s. So at that particular time, I did own a very successful business that I was running on the side that dealt with antiques and collectibles, and it was video games. I know a lot about the vintage video game marketplace as a result. Well, that particular business, when I got sick, I decided to sell that particular business. And I ended up selling it for low six figures. I took the money and I got involved back into corporate America. That's pretty much how I got the job that I still have to this day. It was pretty much through the sale of that business. Well, the one thing that I will tell you is I didn't know I had celiac disease at that time. I just kept getting sicker and sicker. Well, doctors didn't diagnose me with celiac until 2012, 2013. And what I will tell you is when that occurred, I realized that I made a drastic mistake selling that business for as cheap as I did, because today that business would be worth multi-millions of dollars just because of the amount of money that's been pouring into the vintage video game space. Now, there is some upside here, guys. If you're wondering, in every video, I tell you guys to sell in to that particular market, meaning vintage graded video games. The icing on the cake was, even though I sold off the business, I got to keep my inventory. So I have a lot of factory sealed vintage Nintendo, Super Nintendo, Genesis, TurboGrafx, even to a certain extent, Neo Geo games, Sega Saturn import games, PlayStation import games in my collection. Now, I will tell you, my stock is running low because, again, I am selling into this market, but I did very well thanks to the advent or creation of WADA Games. So that's why when you guys criticize me and say, you're biased against video games, I'm not. I'm profiting handsomely from video games. But this channel is about the truth as to what's occurring in the overall antiques and collectibles trade. And that is, at present time, in the year 2021, the vintage video game marketplace has been manipulated. Make no mistake, it is being manipulated, and it's being sold to the highest bidder. It's being packaged, resold to the highest bidder. And a lot of you guys out there, you're falling for it because you have an emotional attachment to these items. You need to remove yourself from the emotional attachment. Take a step back and analyze these markets logically. Next question. Sean, are you married or dating anyone at present time? Okay, this kind of goes back to regrets in life. I told you I developed celiac disease in my late 20s and wasn't diagnosed in my early 30s. One of my big regrets is I lost roughly 5 to 7 years in the dating pool, because when I was very sick, I pulled myself out of the dating pool. So that was one of my major regrets, because this question and answer may surprise you. I've always valued marriage. I always wanted to have kids. And here I am at 44, 45 years old, and I am unfortunately forced to go back into the dating pool. And I do not like hookup culture. I do not like what's happening in the overall dating market. I think both men and women are completely insane. I think a lot of you guys that watch all this red pill content and all you do is consume red pill content, I think you're making a vital mistake. I think women also, they're partaking now in hookup culture. They're putting themselves out there more. They're trying to go all the way into their late 30s, early 40s without getting married because they want to play the field. They're making a mistake because I'm going to tell you, ladies, most of the women that I date are in their 30s. I date very few women my own age, and that's just due to circumstance. And a lot of people go, well, why is that? Well, number one, I value marriage and I do want to have kids. Hint, hint. Most 42-year-old, 43-year-old, 44-year-old women are not in a position where they want to have a kid. And number two, simply because I can. I hate to say it, but I have luck dating younger women. So if you have luck doing something, why wouldn't you do it? You know, a lot of you guys get into destructive relationships, and I never ever understood why. And then it really dawned on me. It's because a lot of guys out there, they don't have a choice. They only have like one or two women that are interested in them. And sometimes those women have extremely, extremely destructive personalities or lives. And because they're so desperate, they go after those women. That's something that I never wanted to do. And for the record, I have been in some toxic relationships. I have been with borderlines. I have been with narcissists. I have been with covert narcissists. And as I get older, one of the things I can tell you is I never want to repeat those mistakes or those relationships again. I don't even want to hook up with women like that because let's be realistic. For those of you guys that have experience in the dating world, you know you can't just hook up with a borderline woman or even a narcissistic woman. She's going to pull it along to the point where it ends up into some type of dramatic relationship, for better or worse. So you guys really got to be careful who you get involved with. Be careful that you vet women. You know, even me, I go into the dating world. I go on Bumble. I go on Match. Sometimes I'll utilize Talkify. Sometimes I've even used Vita Select, if you want to look that up, where they pretty much handle all the communication. All I got to do is pretty much show up at the date. And I will tell you, I get some really gorgeous women that want to pull me into like a sexual relationship right away. And I'm always hesitant because usually that means there's a reason why she's trying to pull you into a sexual relationship to get you hooked. And some of you guys, I don't think are able to stand back and say, wait a minute, where's this going to go if I do hook up with this particular person? You have to be willing to sacrifice your own needs and bet somebody that you're going to bring into your life because potentially they could literally take down your empire. And that's why a lot of you guys, you're trying to build something, you meet a chick or a chick comes along and she becomes your 100% focus. Or she's crazy and you get sucked into that craziness, you're gonna have a hard time recovering. Believe me, guys, I speak from experience. I've been there. I've done it. I know. I can relate to you guys in this particular perspective. I understand why some of you guys are getting involved with these chicks, but where I'm at right now, I don't want anything to do with those type of women. You know, I even tell women, do the work on yourself. If you can do the work on yourself, you want to come back to me at 5-10 years. You know, if I'm still single, hey, we'll see where it goes. In most cases, though, newsflash, those women normally don't want to do the work on themselves. So I know they ain't coming back. Next question. Sean, I'd love to hear your estimates on the total number of collectors in various markets. I have no clue. Okay. Before we go any further in this particular question, I just want to state, I am going to be doing more videos on demographics. I am going to be doing more videos on understanding market caps in collectibles. I will tell you, these are some of the more advanced subject matter or topics that I'm going to teach on this channel, especially when we get into market caps, because even if you pull experts in any collecting market, experts in the entire antiques and collectibles trade, they do differ a little bit on how they analyze market caps. Market caps are very hard to gauge in the overall antiques and collectibles trade, just due to the fact that the only constant in the trade overall is change. And you also have to look at what the market's doing at any given time. For instance, right now, video games are in a massive speculative euphoria. Is that gonna hold? Is it gonna pull back? How's that market gonna work? Well, if you analyze the market cap of vintage video games, just vintage video games, not modern, just vintage at present time, you need to understand that you might be getting incorrect data when you try to analyze that market over a 10-year or a 20-year period. It's just like rare coins. If you look at rare coins, if you take a graph of the rare coin marketplace in the year 2021 and you chart it from the 1960s to the year 2021, you're going to notice something. In the 1980s, there's going to be the graph goes straight up because there was a massive speculative bubble in rare coins. Then in the 1990s, it starts to come down. Well, every critic that I have on this channel who needs to, whatever reason, try to discredit another collecting market to try to prop up theirs, which I really don't get, will come to me and they'll go, Sean, I've done the research. Rare coins, that's a bad market to invest in. Do you see in the 1980s and the 1990s when that market crashed? Yes, Timmy, I do. You need to understand your precious video games or Magic the Gathering cards or Pokemon cards or vintage toys can easily do the same thing. Because there was a massive speculative euphoria that happened in rare coins in the 1980s, extending all the way to the early 1990s, when hedge funds, when Wall Street, when grading companies says, we can make this a thing and we're going to pimp it out to the masses. Well, guess what happened? The masses got involved. That's what everybody wanted, right? And what happened? The market eventually crashed. Sound familiar, video game collectors? When we talk about WADA, when we talk about no population reports, when we talk about grading companies representing clients, where I have a client that really is interested in this game. He might sell it. And you're the grading company and you're representing a client. This all happened before. It all happened before and it did not work out great, guys. It did not work out well at all. We've seen it. Learn from this. I'm going to take a few more questions here. Next question. Okay. This question is completely convoluted. I am not going to read it because it's literally two paragraphs long. All is what this person is really asking me is my thoughts on the gold standard. Here are my simple, unbiased thoughts on the gold standard. In the year 2021, the gold standard in the United States would never work. Both political parties don't want it. It doesn't matter if you seem to think that your top five political candidates are going to reinstate the gold standard. I can tell you firsthand, once they get elected to office, once they get in there, and once all these corporate donors grease their palms with all that fresh money, they will no longer agree to the gold standard. There are very few people serving in the U.S. Congress or the Senate or even at the presidential level that want the gold standard. And if you are a Republican, you actually are going to realize that a lot of the politicians that push wealth inequality, that push tax cuts for the rich, they don't want the gold standard either because their donors don't want it. On the Democratic side, let me let you in a secret. Those of you that think the Democrats are spending to infinity, the Democrats, they're blowing the budget out of proportion. Guess what? If that's true, they don't want the gold standard either because now it ties them to fiscal responsibility. So both parties do not want the gold standard. And again, for the record, I am a liberal progressive. I am on the left side of the equation. You will never get a gold standard passed in the United States ever again, not the way that it was back before FDR first deregulated it, then Nixon came in and did away with it. If you want proof, there's proof for you. The first administration that did away with the gold standard was, full disclosure, he was one of my favorite presidents, was FDR. Then Nixon, a Republican, got elected, came in, and he completely killed the gold standard. Reagan made no reference to the gold standard in the 1980s, and he is a beloved Republican president. He's not my favorite president, but if he's yours, I respect your opinion. But I will state, the gold standard is pretty much dead. So why are we even having this conversation? It goes back where, if you ask me, Sean, do you think the United States should have socialized medicine? The answer is yes. Now, if you disagree with that standpoint, you can spend 2 hours cutting me up in the comment section below. Here's the thing. In the year 2021, when we can barely get Obamacare instated properly, do we really think socialized medicine in the United States is going to become a thing? The answer is no. So it doesn't matter what I think. It doesn't matter what you think. Are we really going to spend our time creating activism for a lot of these things that should be, when in all actuality, our time's better spent becoming a better person, both physically, mentally, emotionally, financially, spiritually, just helping each other as a decent human being. That's probably what we should be spending our time. Not worrying about socialized medicine, not worrying about the gold standard, not worrying about climate change, because I have people that come into the comment section, they tell me climate change doesn't exist. On the other end of the spectrum, they think that climate change is the greatest threat to humanity. Honestly, I'm here to tell you, I believe in climate change. Climate change is a problem. We do have to take action. But if you look, President Biden, isn't doing too much to address climate change with that wonderful filibuster hanging over the U.S. Senate, isn't he? So what are you going to do? Are you going to spend your time writing to all whatever, how many, 50, 51 senators that are Democratic right now, trying to tell them they need to do away with the filibuster because the planet's dying? It's not going to do anything, guys. At the end of the day, our political system is centrist. Doesn't matter if you're a libertarian, doesn't matter if you're a liberal progressive, doesn't matter if you're an independent, doesn't matter if you're a moderate Republican, moderate Democrat. At the end of the day, you get centrism. Whenever we go to one side too far, we come right back to the center. That's the way it's been pretty much for 100 years, since FDR. FDR, as a matter of fact, was, whether you like him or love him, he was one of the most successful presidents ever because of everything that he was able to put through. Well, if you look, literally since the 1980s, Republicans have done an excellent job at chipping away at everything that he built. And again, I'm not taking sides. I'm just saying, does this conversation matter? Final question I've saved for this Q&A is about me personally, so I do want to answer this. Sean, it's more of a compliment, but how do you look so terrific? Your skin and hair looks great, and your energy is contagious, even in your 40s. Do you use moisturizer? Do you use Botox? Clean eating and exercise? Keep it rocking, brother. Okay, I want to thank you for the compliment. I will tell you, yes, I do have certain skin routines. I do use certain advantages that I have at my disposal to make myself look young. Full disclosure, I don't do anything too drastic. I will tell you, I do get chemical peels. I have had, if you want to look this up, Halo laser surgery. Halo is H-A-L-O, just like the video game. If you look up Halo laser, you're going to come across articles where it's pretty much a laser treatment that's fairly expensive. It costs like close to $2,000. And they take a laser to your face and it pretty much smooths out thin lines, wrinkles. It also gets rid of dark spots. I have had that done several times. Everybody always asks me, and I want to answer this, have I ever had cosmetic surgery? The answer is yes, but not to the degree that a lot of you think. If you literally go back to the very first video that I produced on this channel, at that particular point, I had no cosmetic surgery. The only cosmetic surgery that I had was pretty much in September of 2020. I did get my nose done. I had a very bulbous tip nose that was literally getting worse as I aged. So I went to a plastic surgeon. I went to one of the top plastic surgeons in Philadelphia, and I did have an open rhinoplasty is what it's called. I also had fat taken from my side and injected into my face. So if you guys want something to laugh at, there you go. I don't mind. I am a product of a superficial society. So as a result, I do have to keep myself looking good. If you have the means, it is something that most of you are going to get involved in at some point because you're all going to age. Another question that I get asked, and I do want to answer this because it's such an interesting question. A lot of people look at my hair and they go, wow, he's 45 and he almost has a full head of hair. So they automatically ask me, hey, Sean, have you ever had a hair transplant, any procedures like that? Because the only way that we know to look at you is through this particular YouTube channel, and we've only seen you since 2019. I have never had a hair transplant. I will tell you, I am a Norwood 2. If you know what that means on the hair loss scale, I do have a maturing hairline. I will tell you this, I'm going to answer 100% honestly. Yes, if my hair loss ever got consistently bad, I would go in for a hair transplant. The techniques that they have today are just incredible. I've seen them firsthand because I do have friends that have gotten hair transplants. Other questions I do want to answer here. I do not currently have Botox. I would like to eventually get Botox. The thing about Botox is it only lasts 3 to 4 months and it is quite expensive. So therefore, with us being still kind of in a pandemic situation, it's not worth me spending the money on Botox at present time to keep that going. However, soon as the pandemic starts to at least end with no fear of the Delta variant coming back, I will probably get back into that type of routine. I have had Botox before. It's very subtle when I get it done. I don't overdo it. I do eat right because I am celiac diseased. So as a result, gluten intolerant. I do eat a lot of Mediterranean style dishes, a lot of rice, chicken, fish, a lot of items of that nature. Another question that I will answer, exercise. I go to the gym at least once or twice a day. I am very big into exercise, staying active. I do play. I'm not going to comment on this too much, but extreme sports. I am into a lot of crazy stuff on that end. So I do like keeping my body at least healthy. I am not trying to build muscle. For those of you guys that reach out and tell me, he goes to the gym all the time. He doesn't look like Arnold Schwarzenegger. Ha, ha, ha. I like to keep an athletic build, or what I call a swimmer's body, meaning the nice V shape. That's what I'm going for. I'm not trying to get my biceps out to here, guys. That's not something that I want. It's not going to look right on me. So I do work out a lot. Aside from that, what I will tell you is everybody's going to age. A lot of it's predicted by your genes. I hate to say that. However, medical science has come to the manner where if you have the means, yes, you can make yourself look better. Just do not overdo it. A lot of you guys are making a mistake. You're in your 20s and you're getting extreme cosmetic surgery. And I don't care if you're a male or a female watching this. It looks horrible. And I'm going to tell you, if you get cosmetic surgery, if you get plastic surgery where they're cutting skin or they're putting implants into your face or body in your 20s, you're going to have problems 10, 20 years out, even possibly 5 years out. Because what happens is implants shift, your skin has memory, and it changes shape again. So that's why you have people that had a lot of plastic surgery in their younger years. They look very janky in their 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s and beyond. So be very careful if that is you guys. At the end of the day, most of you are better off just eating right, exercising, using moisturizer, taking care of yourself, and being kind to others. And that's how I am going to end this video. Thank you for watching the 6,000 subscriber Q&A series. I hope it lived up to the hype. Enjoy your day, and I will see you in another video.